I'm going to ask that we all bow our heads in prayer.
Just start rattling off all the bad things I've done until you get tired of hearing about it, or what?
I'm going to talk to you about the judge of the fatherless.
I'm sure he doesn't mean to be so difficult, Mrs. Cleaver. It's just that he's at the age where he doesn't realize how important it is to keep a promise.
Which Bible stories you want to hear? It's just a Sunday school.
Thanks, Dad.
Welcome to the Faith of the Fathers podcast. I'm your host, Carl Gessler, where we are, I always say we, but I mean I am trying to reignite the calling of men in the world. For some reason, I guess it's an insecurity in me that I often say we, which it's really me, sometimes my wife, but she's only doing things that I make her do. So it's really me. I think when I say we, it's like, oh, it sounds like there's a bunch of people behind me. And so really, you should be on board this train. So sorry, I start out each podcast manipulating you, but I'll try to work on that. Anyway, I'm here to reignite the calling of men in the world. And I'm excited to do today's podcast because I'm talking about at least two things that I love, which is justice, the topic of justice and theology. Everybody has a theology. But a lot of people don't know what their theology is, but they have a working theology. You really can't make decisions in life without theology, because theology is a study of God. Whatever you think about God is what makes you, leads you to make the decisions that you make in your life, including not believing in God at all, saying that there is no God. That will lead you to make value decisions in your life about what you think is important, what's not important, based upon your assertion that God doesn't exist. Everybody has a theology. The theologies that get us in trouble are the ones we don't acknowledge, the ones that we just assume, we never question. And so when we have problems in our life that we can't resolve, we never even think about our theology, because it, like I said, we don't question it. And so we never find a solution to the obstacle in our life because we have never looked at the problem. It's like trying to fix a leak and you're just looking in all the wrong places. You know, it's at a joint underneath the handle, but you've looked everywhere except there. Well, you're not going to fix the leak if you don't go there. Anyway, so we're going to talk about justice today, particularly what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 6. He says, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for God's justice, for they will be satisfied." And this is part of what we call the Beatitudes. Jesus didn't call it the Beatitudes. It's something later theologians dubbed it. It's an easy way to reference it. There's so much that we can talk about. I'm going to try to stay focused. One of my problems that I have in communicating is trying to say too much at once. And this topic can go in a lot of different directions. People like N.T. Wright have written extensively on this subject. As a matter of fact, I'm quoting that what I just quoted from Matthew 5, 6 is his translation of it. There's been a lot of debate on that. We're not going to be able to get into all of that. We might touch on it a little bit. But I want to just talk about a couple of things. Mainly the reason for this is to ask ourselves, this is the practical application, what is God's justice? What is it that we want? Because there are a lot of people crying out for justice. There have been people crying out for justice in the streets. That's the word that they used up there in Portland and many other places, having these BLM riots and Antifa riots and whatever, people saying it was in the name of justice or against injustice or whatever. And now you have a lot of people, because of the deep corruption in our government, from elections to borders to all sorts of things, there are people crying out for justice, medical tyranny. There are a lot of people wanting justice. And from the circles that I've been in, I hear a lot of people consoling themselves with this statement, God wins. Sometimes it comes across as consolation. They're saying God wins in the end. In the end, God has the final word. And other people say it kind of vindictively, like, God wins. Like, in the end, you're going to get it, bud. And for a lot of us, that is actually the, we want justice, And a lot of times that actually comes out as we want vengeance. And I think we need to figure out the difference between justice and vengeance. But Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for God's justice. And most of you would recognize that more of like the NIV translation or something like that. Most translations would say, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for God's righteousness. And a little theological background on this, that N.T. Wright translates it justice because righteousness has a kind of a different meaning for us. It does mean the same thing. Like if someone does the right thing, they do what is right and what is just. Okay, maybe I'm going to go at this from a little bit of a different angle. Let's just think about this. Hunger and thirst for God's justice. What is God's justice? Justice is simply justice. We talk about truth. People say my truth and your truth, but there's only one truth. It's either true or it's not true. It's a fact or it isn't. It doesn't matter what you think is true. It doesn't matter what you feel is true. There's only one thing that actually is true. There is no relativism when it comes to truth, and there's no relativism when it comes to justice. There are people like my grandfather, actually, who, when he was younger, was in a very strong, hyper-Calvinistic setting where, where Calvinists, the hyper-Calvinists will really drive home this idea that God chooses people who are going to be saved, and he chooses people who are not going to be saved. So he chooses people who will get to go to heaven, and he'll choose people who have to go to hell because, you did not choose me, I chose you, they'll say. And when people cry out, that's not just, which a lot of people think that's what Paul's talking about in Romans 9, where he says, who are you, O man, to speak back to God? I believe that's a misinterpretation. But anyway, my grandfather would say, well, it's just if God does it. So it may seem unjust to us, but if God does it, it's just. And so we might look at this and say, oh, that's God's justice. But that is incorrect. There's no way that that can be right, because that is no different than the relativism that says my truth and your truth are equal, and you just choose what you believe to be true. Nobody chooses to believe what is true. They don't create truth by professing a theory and saying, I ascribe to this. Your theory is a theory. That's what it is. It's not truth. Truth is the one reality. You know, we all have our ideas about how the world works, but there's only one reality, and that is truth. There's only one justice. So God's justice, when Jesus says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for God's justice, he's not referring to something, God's own definition, his unique definition of justice, which none of us knows, and only, and God doesn't have to justify himself to us. He can just claim, this is right for me to do, even if you don't understand it. If it makes no sense to you, too bad, I'm God, and you don't get to question me. That's not what it is. God's justice is that statement is possessive. Or if you say God's righteousness, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for God's righteousness. They shall be satisfied. Again, righteousness is the same. God's righteousness is what is righteous. What is right and good and just and true is only one thing. So God's justice is his own. It has to be something that is uniquely his. What does God possess? His own behavior. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for God to do what he promised to do. This is a reference Jesus is making to God's own behavior when God acts justly. You could say, well, what do you mean? Has there ever been something where God has not acted justly? The answer is no, but in the waiting period, many of us doubt God's justice, God's faithfulness, God's righteousness, because it doesn't appear at the moment that justice is being done. Particularly in the gospel narrative story, God makes a promise. In Genesis 15, he makes a promise to Abraham. He says, Abraham, in you and in your family, I'm going to bless all nations. And the way that Genesis tells the story is that what God created a good world, it went bad. But what went wrong in Adam, God promises to fix in Abraham. As soon as God promised to do that, God entered into a covenant with Abraham. And in the story of Genesis, you can read it. It's Genesis 12 through, I think, 17, where there are multiple encounters with God. But God says, I'm going to do this, Abraham. And he puts Abraham in a deep sleep. He cuts animals in two. And in the form of a torch, God walks through the slaughtered animals. And by this, he's symbolically saying, if I don't keep my promise, let me be as these animals. So God swore on his own life to do this thing, to bless all nations in and through Abraham's family. Well, if you know the story of the Bible, Abraham's family eventually grows, and then they go to Egypt, and then they become slaves in Egypt for 400 years. And God promised that this would happen. But eventually, he delivers them. Through Moses, they enter the promised land, and the people are learning, wow, this God of Abraham is legit. He told us he would do this, and now it's happening. But still, for thousands of years, Israel struggled with being faithful to the God of Abraham, and the world had not been made right. It still hadn't been made right. In some ways, the Jewish people's existence, Israel's existence, and the Torah, the law that God gave them, was a measure of God putting the world right. Israel's Torah, what we call the law, was seen as something really interesting to the pagan nations around. No one had anything quite like the Torah. No one had anything that protected women and honored the weak like the Torah. That was unique to the culture of Israel. But of course, Israel struggled to keep it themselves, and they were still ruled over by pagan nations, people who didn't worship the God of Israel. And so they are like waiting, God, when are you going to do this thing that somehow what went wrong in Adam is going to be made right in Abraham? Because here we are, we're still struggling, we're still oppressed by people who don't worship the one true God, and we're still a contradiction in ourselves. We're saying that we need to be holy, and yet we fail to be holy ourselves. This is the dramatic story that Matthew is telling. The Gospels are good news because it's the climax of the story. It's saying after all this time, after all these years, after this winding story of Israel, all her ups and downs, her joys and her heartbreak and her sorrows and her weeping, Jesus is announcing that the kingdom of God is now arriving. And that's what he's saying as on the Sermon of on the Mount or the Beatitudes. He's saying the kingdom of God is arriving. Jesus has already healed people. He's cast out demons. He has backed up his claim with these acts that are his credentials. And now he's saying what this means. I'm announcing to you who is going to be blessed by this. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit or the humble. And he says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for God's justice. You will be satisfied. And what he's saying in that is those of you who have been waiting for God to do what he promised, those of you who have been waiting for God to keep his covenant, good news, it's happening right here, right now. That is the gospel claim. That's why it's good news. It's not good advice. It's not advice about how to secure a better afterlife. It is news about something that's happened in our world right here, right now. That's how news works. For us, that is, I think, it's confusing. I mean, it's like, it sounds like it should be exciting, yet you and I both know that we're living in a world where the right thing is oftentimes not done. Wickedness is done in dark places, and many times the victim has no voice, and then they do get a voice, but nobody really is quite listening to them, only a handful of people. And the law enforcement isn't listening to them, and the court system is not listening to them. We all know this experience. So was Jesus right? Was he correct to say, blessed are you who have been hungering and thirsting for God's justice, because you will be satisfied? Are we satisfied? Well, I'm not satisfied with the way things are in my own country here in the United States of America. I'm very angered. I am very disappointed. I'm grieved. I'm grieved at many of the things that my nation has done in recent history. And it's not the things that the media claims that we have done. We have abandoned God. We have abandoned the fear of God. We have abandoned law and order. We have abandoned children in the womb. We have subjected our kids in public schools to sexual grooming. We have done all sorts of evil and wicked things. We have some people within our government call our own founding documents dangerous. They've labeled the Constitution with warnings of trigger warnings because of hateful speech in it. Utter nonsense. I'm looking at that and saying, wow, this is messed up. This is wrong. I look at what happened in our in the election of 2020 and say, like, we are not in control of this country. We've been lied to for generation after generation. You know, that's me. Those are the things that I'm struggling with. And of course, abortion. You know, the abortion issue. We know what that is. It doesn't take a genius to figure out that a baby is a baby. It doesn't take a genius to figure out that when you end a pregnancy, you end a human life. We know that's unjust. We've been crying out against that for years, and we have seen little in the way of making that wrong right. So was Jesus wrong? Was he wrong to announce that we will be satisfied? Maybe he should have said, and maybe this is what you think he means, that when you die and go to heaven, everything will be better. That answer, I mean, when you die, if you are in Christ, if Christ is in you, if the Spirit of God abides in you, when you die, you will be with Jesus. That's good news. That is comforting news. That is, you know, what Jesus said to the man on the cross, today you'll be with me in paradise. I believe that. That is what the Bible teaches. But that is not what the gospel is about. From the very beginning, the gospel story is about this planet. It's about God creating a good world, and he placed us to bear his image in it. And yes, evil entered the world, but that, in God's strange purposes, has its role to play as well. I'm not saying God created evil, but he created a world where evil was possible. And yet the final story of this world is not it being corrupted to the point of no return. It's about redemption. It's about healing God's good creation project and getting it, continuing it on into the on the path that God intended for it to be, which the prophet said that the earth will be full of the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. The Apostle Paul says in the book of Romans that God didn't promise Abraham just a little spot in the Middle East. He says this in Romans 4. He says that God promised Abraham the world. I think that's in Romans 4. It's definitely in Romans. But he promised Abraham the entire world. Jesus said in the Beatitudes that the meek will inherit the earth. The thing that we are looking for, the thing that we are waiting for, is God to renew this planet, which means that justice ultimately has to be done. Now, Jesus announced that the gospel was now what he was saying. You will be satisfied. So what did God promise to do? He promised to fix the world. Jesus claims that he's doing it. And he's backing it up with the fact that he's healing people of diseases and he's casting out demons. A lot of people believe that that doesn't happen today. But I think that's just absurd. If you don't think that happens today, you don't know what the church is like in around the world. There are people, many people, I know people personally, who have witnessed people being raised from the dead several times. I know people who have been healed of terminal cancer. I know people who have been healed of full-blown AIDS and on their deathbed. You know, God heals, Jesus heals today. I know people who have been delivered from demons. Jesus is still active and alive today, right now. And these things take place in the name of Jesus, which is part of the answer to our question. Was Jesus telling the truth? Yes, look what happens when we pray in his name. The same things happen that happened in the Bible. But what about ultimate justice? Well, what is ultimate justice? If you were abused as a child, and many of us have been in various ways, some people in very minor ways. I think everybody, because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, we have all abused somebody else to some extent. Anything that doesn't reflect the glory of God, doesn't reflect who He is damaging to other human beings. So we have all been abused. We all know what it's like to be treated unfairly, unjustly, even to be treated as less than human. And we cry out for that to be made right. A lot of us believe that if we could get vengeance, if we could do the same thing to them that they did to us, then we would be satisfied. This is why murder, one of the reasons why murder happens. People say, I'm going to get you the same or more than you got me. And of course, we know, we do know that that doesn't satisfy. We know it's true when we see it in other people that someone's consumed with hatred and anger. You're kind of afraid to be around that person. We may understand it because we may know there are a lot of people that have had terrible, terrible things done to them. There are a lot of children down in near our border that are having terrible things done to them right now. And growing up with that kind of abuse, I can understand that there would be rage and hatred in somebody. But to kill your enemy is not to make the world right. And I think this is why, we've been talking a lot about Christian resistance and Christians in the military recently. And this is the thing, and this is what I think Jesus was getting at when he was telling Peter to put his sword away. Jesus came to fix what was broken in the world. I believe that the sword, the metaphorical sword, the weapons that humans have developed have a necessary and redemptive purpose in stopping the bleeding. When you see injustice happening and you are able, you are empowered to do something about stopping the evil in its tracks, that is the proper use of force. That is, what Paul says in Romans 13:4, that the government has the sword for that purpose, to stop evil. But it doesn't fix the problem. It only stops that particular evil from happening in that moment. How do you heal? How do you restore what has been damaged? Because you may be able to kill the person that injured you, that hurt you, that wounded you, but that won't make you healed. I do think that it's important that when people have been abused, that we acknowledge the abuse as abuse. A lot of times I think people try to deal with their feelings of hatred and anger because they know it's not right, and they know no one really wants to see that. They try to deal with it by playing down what happened to them, saying to themselves and to others, well, it wasn't so bad, I can handle it. Just trying to make excuses for the person that perpetrated the crime. But that's not going to get us freedom either. We have to recognize how bad is. We have to recognize evil for what it is. And we have to deal with reality. We have to deal with truth. And then that's the only way we're going to get to go forward. Because what Jesus did, everything, Matthew 5 is where we find the Beatitudes, where Jesus is making this claim that you're blessed. If you've been hungering and thirsting for God's justice, you're blessed because it's happening right here, right now. Everything that happens in Matthew's 28 chapters, so the 23 chapters after that is built on the claim that Jesus made that the kingdom of God is arriving on earth as it is in heaven. What he's saying is throughout those chapters is this is what it looks like when God becomes king. This is what it looks like when God's in charge. He's healing the sick. He's raising the dead. He's also forgiving sins. And people ask him, how do you have the authority to forgive sins? Only God can forgive sins. You have to have some kind of authority. You have to have some kind of resource to be able to claim the forgiveness of sins. So if I know someone Say I know this guy that he raped a girl. And the girl had no relation to me. It was, you know, other than she was a human being and I care about that. I'm just saying there's no like personal, I have no personal authority to forgive on behalf of that girl. But what if I said to this, the rapist, I said, your sins are forgiven. And I know stories of judges that have forgiven crimes of the criminal, even when the victim was not offering forgiveness. The judge in that case doesn't have authority to forgive a crime that wasn't committed against him. Now, of course, all sins are sins against God, but we're not to, you know, the Gospels don't start from a position of, hey, Jesus is God. They ultimately draw that conclusion, but the first claim they make about Jesus is that he's the Messiah. He's the one through whom God is making the world right. So when he starts telling people your sins are forgiven, it's right to say, wait, what authority, what right do you have to forgive sins committed against somebody else? You should only be able to forgive sins that were committed against you. And the reason Jesus has that authority is because he is the one that's going to pay the price of the wrongdoing. You know, that all the sins of the world, this is what theologians have said since Jesus, that all the sins of the world were laid on Jesus's shoulders. Jesus didn't come to forgive, Jesus came to carry the weight of all that brokenness in the world, all sins ever committed on his own shoulders. This is what servant leadership is all about. This is what it means to be truly human. Jesus is saying and doing, he's saying, I am the one that's going to fix it. I'm the one that's going to pay the price for that. The reason Jesus gets crucified is because all the powers of the world who didn't want to take responsibility for what was wrong in the world, they all made him the scapegoat, which is ironic. Maybe it's not ironic, it's prophetic. The Israelite leaders, they thought that Jesus was dangerous. They thought that if Jesus continued on, the people would really believe in him. He'd get a following and Rome would come and squelch it and they would lose their power because they would all be in trouble because of this revolutionary. So they offered him up as a sacrifice lamb. They said, let this man die instead of all the people. And the Romans, you know, Pontius Pilate, the reason he killed Jesus was because the Jewish leaders were threatening a riot. Pilate had already made some serious political blunders with the Jewish people, and if there was another riot under his watch, he would get disciplined by Rome, removed, and who knows what else. So Pilate, as a matter of convenience, as a matter of personal preservation, offers up Jesus and says, okay, you know, what is truth? You know, he had Jesus... He just questions whether or not you can even know truth, which is always a convenient thing for people who need to justify their unjust decision. They just, oh, there's no meaning in anything. So I'm just going to do this thing to preserve myself. There's no justice. And Rome claimed to have justice. So all the powers of the world surrendered Jesus up, including the disciples. When Jesus was arrested, they ran and hid. They didn't want to be associated with this man who is being arrested now, because they thought if God was with him, that would never happen. And if he's getting arrested, maybe the stuff we believed about Jesus was wrong, because this is unjust. This is what we thought the Messiah was going to stop. And I've talked about this before, but I believe that Judas's main beef with Jesus, I don't think Judas betrayed Jesus for the love of money. He may have had a love for money, but he betrayed Jesus because he was trying to provoke Jesus to the actions that he thought. Because Judas was a revolutionary and he wanted Jesus to use his power the way that he thought it should be done, which would be go attack Rome and give what Rome has to the Jewish people. But Jesus wouldn't do that, and instead he got arrested. And so everybody is sacrificing Jesus for the sake of preserving their dream. And Jesus's suffering, ultimately, he took all of the brokenness of the world, and it all aimed at him. All the evil in the world was aimed at Jesus on the cross. Paul talks about this as sin kind of being built up as a heap and doing its worst on Jesus and exhausting its strength. Jesus is then raised from the dead, and through the Holy Spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he puts his spirit in us, in the exact people that Jesus talked about on the Sermon of the Mount, the poor in the spirit, the humble, those who hunger and thirst for God's justice. We can read the Beatitudes and say, is this me? Am I one of these people? Because if I am, Jesus is going to satisfy me. This is one of the remarkable things about Jesus, is that the way God carries out his justice in the world is through the church. Jesus has won the war, but he has left us battles to fight, and he commissions us in his name to go do it. So blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. You will be satisfied. When Jesus was raised from the dead, we are satisfied because we can know for sure, yes, we were right to believe in Jesus because God affirmed him by raising him from the dead. But yet we're like, okay, so what happens next? And that's exactly what the disciples were asking when Jesus rose from the dead. Okay, this is great. This is great. Now, as they say in the beginning of Acts, now are you restoring the kingdom? And Jesus says, it's not for you to know the times and epochs. It's like, basically, you're asking the wrong question. He says, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And I believe what Jesus is saying there is you'll get it. You'll understand what I'm talking about when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, because you will be my witnesses. All authority in heaven and earth, listen, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. And because of that, you are to go and make disciples of all the nations. Remember, Jesus said to his disciples, greater things will you do than me because I go to the Father. Jesus healed the sick, he raised the dead, he cast out demons, he proclaimed forgiveness of sins, and by that he was making the world right again. God confirmed Jesus by raising him from the dead. Yes, this is my son, this is the Messiah, this is what he said is true, believe him, trust him. Jesus said, as the Father sent me into the world, so I send you, receive the Holy Spirit. And so that leaves us as being the people that continue the redemption project of reconciling the world to God, which is justice, bringing things into line the way that it should be. That is the definition of justice, as it should be. The Holy Spirit is in us to give us the wisdom and the power to set things right. And, it's not me, it's Christ in me. But that is something that I cooperate with the Holy Spirit, say, I'm going to go where you lead. And of course, I do that imperfectly, but it's something that I'm learning to do. And here's the real kicker. Jesus brought justice into the world, not by extracting vengeance on his enemies, but by suffering. And why did he suffer? He suffered because he told the truth. A lot of people, when you say that it's not about vengeance, a lot of times people think that means, oh, so it means you have to be soft, you have to be a doormat for the world. No. A lot of the people that are fighting for election integrity have lost everything. I mean, truly, they're fighting because of the fraud from 2020. Many of them are Christian people. They've lost their jobs. They have been had their lives threatened. They have their lives threatened right now. Why? Because they're telling the truth. Because they are sacrificing for the truth. Jesus said that all who follow me will be persecuted. The Apostle Paul said, all those who desire to live godly lives in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. And Jesus said, blessed are you when they persecute you for righteousness' sake. Yours is the kingdom. We can look at those who are suffering because they're speaking the truth. We can look at those who are resisting taking the jab because they are because of conscience, and we can see them losing their jobs. Jesus is saying, blessed are you, the kingdom of heaven belongs to you in that moment. That is when you are trusting that Jesus is Lord and not Caesar. That is the gospel, trusting that Jesus is Lord and not Caesar. That's how justice happens. We may be suffering and saying, well, this doesn't feel right. This isn't right. This isn't just. But by us bearing that injustice, we are paving the way for justice to be done in the future. Just like the people who resisted slavery back in the day. As a matter of fact, we're going to be talking about Charles Spurgeon next week. Charles Spurgeon was a famous preacher in Great Britain, and he was gaining wide popularity throughout the Western world, including in the Southern United States. And this is right before the Civil War. Charles Spurgeon was avidly against slavery. And people told him, if you talk about this, you are going to lose a lot of your financial support from the Southern United States. And he said, I don't care. And he spoke out against it. And that's exactly what happened. He lost a ton of support from the Southern United States. That's a perfect example of someone, he is enduring injustice, but for this, because he's doing that, justice is going to happen in the future. He is paving the way. He is sacrificing so that other people will experience justice. This is what Jesus meant when he said, if you're going to follow me, you must take up your cross and follow me. Jesus brought justice by being a suffering servant. A servant sometimes goes to war for the sake of other people. A soldier puts himself in harm's way for the sake of the innocent. A police officer, a good police officer, risks his own life to protect those who are innocent. This is why Jesus has to be the example. This is why Jesus has to be the center of our law enforcement. Jesus has to be the center of our military. This is something we must get a hold of now. If our military is anti-Christian, our military will be anti-human. It will be against all that is good and right in the world. We must learn to lead like Jesus did, which means I'm going to do what's right at my own cost for the sake of others. That's exactly who Jesus is, and that's exactly who we're called to follow. And those who hunger and thirst for God's justice will recognize God's justice in this, that he is not making someone else pay for your sins. He is paying for it himself. That's a famous hymn. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin has had left its crimson stain, but Jesus washed it white as snow. In the end, God wins. But that doesn't mean that God's victory is going to look like you imagined it. It's going to be better. But you and I might also have to have our own thinking transformed in the process as we cry out for justice. Justice looks like Jesus. Justice looks like Jesus on a cross, and justice looks like Jesus raised from the dead and exalted to the right hand of God the Father. So I hope that encourages you today. I hope that maybe helps you wrap your mind a little bit more around the concept of God's justice. God's justice is God being faithful to what he said he would do, which is to heal the world through the people of Israel. He did that through the faithful Israelite, Jesus of Nazareth. And now he's continuing to do it through Christ in us, the hope of glory, the renewed Israel of God, the people of God, you and I. We are God's answer to the problem of evil. Christ in us, the hope of glory. All right, thanks for being with me. Thanks for sharing this time. I love to hear and read your guys' comments. If you're listening via Apple, iTunes, whatever, please take a minute to rate and review the podcast and share it with somebody you think it'll bless. All right, thanks for being with me, and We'll see you guys next week when we're going to have a special guest on, Nathan Sunt, who's going to be sharing with us some of his insights into the life and victories of Charles Spurgeon, who was known as the Prince of Preachers. All right, we'll see you guys next time. God bless.